You hear the rain trickling onto the pavements. We've ruined the climate in the future. It is, of course, the love theme from Blade Runner, written by the late Vangelis, dead at the age of 79, just a week or so after his 79th birthday. Playing this to welcome aboard. Normally it's the Pearl and Dean theme, but I thought we'd go a bit more arty and neo-noir of the future. Van, to say hello to Van Connor with his Freeview film recommendations. This is just lovely, isn't it? What a soundtrack this is, Blade Runner.
Whoa, you can't be a bit of Vangelis, can you?
In fact, I'm glad you said
1492
that.
Was always my favourite.
Oh, yeah, of course. That was another Ridley Scott film, wasn't it? The Columbus movie.
Mm.
I think none of those made much money, did they? There were two rival ones, and then they also committed Carry On Columbus around that time. That absolute turkey when they tried to revive the franchise on that one. Let me play you another burst of Blade Runner. I think you know where I'm going. I think one of the greatest speeches in movie history, and it's really, I think, written by Rutger Hauer as the leader of the killer androids. They've got a short life. His is about to end. He could well take Harrison Ford's character with him. Deckard, I think it's called, before he goes. Spoiler alert, he chooses not to. Instead, written by Rutger Hauer, he gives this speech instead about the what will happen to his memories when his life is soon over. Fantastic, with music by Vangelis to break your heart.
I've seen things you people wouldn't believe. Attack ships on fire off the shoulder of Orion. I watched sea beams glitter in the dark near the Tannhauser Gate. All those moments will be lost in time, like tears in rain.
I tell you what, I'm going to go and watch Blade Runner now and Blade Runner 2049 after that. It wasn't on this weekend by a lack of foresight, so that would be my selection. Instead, you've got three Freeview film recommendations for the weekend. I've got three. And you want to start with, and again, underrated film. I think Sandra Bullock's in this, is she not? Demolition Man.
Yes, Demolition. I think this was the big breakout film for Sandra Bullock. She did Speed with Keanu Reeves a year later, and that would be the big, massive smash hit that made her name. But Demolition Man's kind of the first time she turned up on a lot of our radars. She is, of course, a sidekick in this one to Sylvester Stallone, who is the wrongly convicted cop who has been put into a cryo prison and is then released when the terrorist who put him there, played by Wesley Snipes as Simon Phoenix, the coolest man to ever pull off dungarees, escapes the cryo prison and sets himself loose on what can only be described as a very sanitized, very politically correct, very socially conscious society of 2032. They don't know how to handle a terrorist. They don't have violence. As we're told at one point, they haven't had a murder in decades. So they have to thaw out the ultimate renegade 90s cop, the so-called Demolition Man, John Spartan, played by Stallone, in order to basically bring Wesley Snipes to justice and save the day. But of course, it's not a world that he's used to either, as you'll hear in our clip in a moment. It's a comedy of errors as much as it is a fish out of water comedy, in a way, as much as it is this great big satirical action film. It is hilarious. It is just blisteringly action packed. It's on ITV4 tonight at 9 p.m. It's one of those movies that only seems to get better and funnier with age, with its weird predictions about the future that seem to weirdly keep coming true. I mean, there's an offhand reference in the movie about Schwarzenegger going into politics. This was 1993.
Wow.
They didn't know that he could do that. Turned out it only took a decade for him to actually go and do it. Demolition Man, though, one of my all-time top 10 favorite action movies. I love this movie so much. Props as well for Bob Gunton, Benjamin Bratt, and Dennis Leary, who are in there as well. Just an absolutely brilliant ride of a movie. I've got a clip for you. This is Sylvester Stallone's John Spartan trying to get to grips with how to use the bathroom in the future.
Here we go then. ITV4, enjoy. Who doesn't love Demolition Man?
I don't know if you guys know it, but you're... You're out of toilet paper.
Did you say toilet paper?
Oh, they used handfuls of wadded paper back in the 20s.
I'm happy that you're happy, but the place where you're supposed to have the toilet paper, you got this little shelf with three seashells on it.
He doesn't know how to use the three seashells.
I can see how that could be confusing.
Oh, that is a funny film, and I forgot the kind of satirical element of it. And talking of satire, the director of my first choice made a couple of great satires, I think, one of which was written by the man who also gave us this rather fine film indeed. The film is Basic Instinct. It's 30 years old this year. Sharon Stone, of course, as we know, going a bit commando. Michael Douglas wearing the weirdest jumper. Nobody wears a jumper to a disco when you get all sweaty. But he does. Looking very, he looks 80s, but set in the 90s. Huge successful film. This was an absolutely monster earner. Directed by Paul Verhoeven, who made RoboCop, which is brilliant. He also made, of course, Starship Troopers. And he worked, I think, with the writer Joe Estahayes on Showgirls, which is one of those Marmite films. People think it's mad. I've never actually seen it all the way through because it seems to turn up very late and I'm not off for it. Anyway, the film's great. As we know, it's a did she or didn't she murder mystery about is she or isn't she the psychopathic ice blonde that Hitchcock was always fantasizing about. I mean, it made an absolute fortune, this film. It was a little bit of a game changer in that it presented Michael Douglas was constantly being surrounded around this period by terrifying killer women. Is he not? They seem to seek him out, as in Fatal Attraction. So this is a good old film. I mean, it's absolute arrant nonsense, but I think it made an absolute fortune at the time and almost passed into the language because of the leg crossing scene in the interview or interrogation. It's on 9 o'clock tonight. Great movies. Is this a bit of a guilty pleasure of yours or not so guilty pleasure, this one?
I absolutely love Basic Instinct. It forms a sort of unofficial trilogy for Michael Douglas. There's three Michael Douglas and Psycho Women movies, and I think Basic Instinct is the second one. The first one, of course, is Fatal Attraction, and there's Basic Instinct, and Disclosure sort of rounds off the set. So I think it's Glenn Close, Sharon Stone, and then Demi Moore are all of his Psycho Women over the years. As you point out, the thing I always remember from Basic Instinct, aside from, you know, the brilliant Joe Estahurst script, incidentally, his book, the screenwriter is the devil. The devil is the screenwriter, or the screenwriter is God. I forget the title of it. Is absolutely brilliant and contains probably the best thing anyone has ever written about Sean Young. Just to tie it back into Blade Runner. Great Paul Verhoeven movie. He was back recently with Benedetta. Brilliant movie. Yeah. If you've not seen that, Paul, right up your alley. Great movie. But it is, of course, it's that Michael Douglas clubbing sweater, that teal green V-neck clubbing sweater that he wears, which is just insane. And do you know what? When you watch it now, no one ever wore that even back then. No. It's worth seeing the movie just to peep, to lay your eyes on the insanity that is the Michael Douglas clubbing sweater.
It's a fantastic film. It's on till like 9 o'clock. Great movies. Enjoy. It's Basic Instinct. Here's a chunk of the trailer.
We got 31...
Does he listen? Of course he doesn't. It wouldn't be a film without it. Let's go for your Saturday recommendation, if we may. Now, I think people have heard of this. I think there's even a TV series spin-off either arrived or on the way. Tell us more about why you've picked Crazy Rich Asians.
Well, Crazy Rich Asians is a favourite of both Bex and I, Rebecca Purfoyt and I. It is a 2018 rom-com, an adaptation of the best-selling novel. I think it's part of a trilogy of novels. The other two instalments are on the way, by all accounts. But this is adapted by John M. Chu, who really was predominantly known as being a sort of a concert movie director. He did Michael Jackson, This Is It, and things like that, and Justin Bieber. And then started to break into actual narrative movies in the 2010s, culminating in this, which was his huge smash hit. Brilliant, sugary, culture clash rom-com in which Constance Wu is the New York University professor who has the dashing hunky boyfriend played by Henry Golding. She agrees to go home with him to a family wedding, meet his family for the first time, only to discover that, well, he's not exactly from an ordinary family. It turns out that, he's actually from something of an Asian wealth dynasty, led by by Michelle Yeoh. His family are this powerful rich family led by Michelle Yeoh, and she starts to find herself sort of caught up in the machinations of the class structure of this family, the idea that she doesn't quite fit, that she is kind of the common girl at the side of this world from which he comes from. Absolutely brilliant. Peppered throughout with this absolutely wonderful soundtrack as well. That's all in the actual in-world language, actually in the native language. So you get pop covers of songs like Yellow and things like that. They're actually in Chinese that are absolutely brilliant. Constance Wu, I think, is great in this. The scene stealer, though, is Michelle Yeoh, hands down. Michelle Yeoh is the MVP.
Yeah.
Just as this perfect Joan Collins-like figure. We talked about this on off-screen this week, and as Beck said, she's intimidated by, you know, coming from this rich family. My response is no, she should be more intimidated that she's going out with Michelle Yeoh's son, as you very quickly discover in this film. She is just ice-cold badassery at its finest. I adore Michelle Yeoh in this film. This is on Saturday night on BBC One, 10:20. Absolutely brilliant Technicolor rom-com to see you through the weekend. This one's just a good time through and through. I've got a clip for you. This is Constance Wu discovering that, well, like you say, he's not exactly short of you, Bob.
10:20, Saturday night, BBC One, tomorrow night, Crazy Rich Asians.
So your family is, like, rich?
We're comfortable.
That is exactly what a super rich person would say. It's not a big deal, obviously. I just think it's kind of weird that I had no idea. I mean, you have a Jamba Juice card. You use my Netflix password. You play basketball at that Y that kind of smells.
I really like that place, thank you very much. And yes, my family has money, but I've always thought of it as theirs, not mine.
Marvellous accent there in that one. That is a good film, actually. Good fun film as well. Now, I've got...
BBC trained.
I've got my... Western of the Weekend, to quote. Now, it's not the remake, which is very good indeed, with Jeff Bridges. It's the original version of True Grit, which is a way away from the Charles Poulter's novel from the year before. So the novel came out in 68. The film was released in 1969, and it won John Wayne his only Oscar, which in part was a kind of, you know, consolation award. He's good in it, but he'd be better in other films, particularly Red River, when he goes more to the dark side. And basically, it's about a girl whose father is murdered. She knows who did it, but people can't track him down, don't have the will to do it, and are frightened of him. So she seeks a man with courage, with minerals, as they say now, but she calls it true grit. And she seizes upon this old, drunken, one-eyed reprobate called Rooster Cogburn, who back in the day was a great sheriff and lawman. These days is basically just a booze hound. She also runs across Glenn Campbell in his only really major screen role, but he's great as this kind of uptight US Marshal, played by Matt Damon, of course, in the remake. And together they go on the trail of this bad guy, and there are ups and downs. There's a learning curve. There's that great Western thing, The Journey, in which you find out more about people, and people reassess their past. It's a very old-fashioned Western, directed by Henry Hathaway, but doesn't mean it's a bad Western. As films go, I think the remake's better, but this has got a great place in cinema history. It's on 5:20 Saturday afternoon, perfect time for it, on ITV4. And I don't know if you've seen, I know you've checked the schedules for your choices, ITV4 Saturday afternoon is basically action and bloke central. They've got Magnificent Seven Ride Again, then they've got True Grit, then they're showing The Dirty Dozen, then there's Minder, and then there's an episode of The Professionals. So basically, I think we know their target audience on Saturday nights, do we not? But I mean, you might as well take The Dirty Dozen and whiz through the adverts. True Grit, though, a cracker from 1969, from the novel by Charles Poulter, and we've got a bijou chunkette of the trailer.
True Grit, a slip of a girl, a pot-bellied, one-eyed Western Marshal, and a Texas Ranger wearing breeches a size too big.
What are you doing?
Looking for sign.
You couldn't see it if you saw it.
They're trailing the most surprised killer the West ever knew.
I'm here to take you back to Fort Smith and hang you.
And I think I will not go. Now, how do you like that?
Now, you mean to say that you won't go with me on your own free will?
You just got it the other way around. Now, you will follow me. I didn't think you'd do it.
She certainly does do it, though, and the film's on Saturday afternoon, evening, 5:20 on ITV4. And my final choice for the weekend is just creeps into the wee small hours of Sunday morning. It's on at 1:10 in the morning on film 4, and it is a film from only, I think, 5 years ago, 2017, Killing of a Sacred Deer. It stars Colin Farrell. It's just got Alicia Silverstone, but Colin Farrell and Nicole Kidman are the main stars in it. And it's based on a, stay with me, folks, ancient Greek tragedy by Euripides. His last play, we think, it was up there with Aeschylus and Sophocles, called Iphigenia at Aulis. And Iphigenia was the daughter of Agamemnon. And when Agamemnon was sailing off for the Trojan War, to make sure they get a decent voyage, he sacrifices his only daughter's life to the gods. That comes back to haunt him when he returns, because his missus knocks him off, Medea, spoiler alert. And it's kind of based on that, about a family sacrifice. Very intriguing film. I've seen it about three times now. I'm not sure it's a film I like, but it's hypnotic, I think, in the way that his other films, The Lobster, the director Yorgos Lanthimos, is, and then he went on to make The Favourite, of course, about the hoity-toity royal gay woman starring Olivia Colman. I bet they don't describe it like that in the pitch, the hoity-toity royal gay woman. But what happens is he bumps into a young man, this cardiac surgeon. He's performing an operation. He takes an interest in a young man, as we find out, because his father had died 10 years before after a road crash and an operation. And he takes the young man home and introduces him to the family, which is an odd family. And then the family starts to fall, the children start to fall very ill. And the father has to make admissions to himself about what happened to the boy's dad, and also make a choice in the family. It's a kind of disturbing film, this, I think, isn't it? But it is, I mean, where do you stand on this one? Because it is, I find, if it's on and I start watching it, I have to keep watching it to try and fathom exactly what it is that makes it so hypnotic to me. But you can't really say it's a likable film, is it?
No, I mean, like you say, it's quite a captivating film. I completely understand where you're coming from, because if I watch 5 minutes of it, I will wind up watching the rest. This was my first, because I missed The Lobster. I think I was away the week it was released, so I didn't get to review it. So I didn't really get my first experience of Yorgos Lanthimos until Killing of a Sacred Deer, which also turned out, I think it's the first time I saw Barry Keoghan.
Yeah, he's great.
Anything. He's
great.
Yeah, he's brilliant. Yeah, and he's obviously gone from strength to strength since. I mean, he turned up in The Batman a couple of months ago, as I think he's meant to be the Joker to was the end of The Batman, but obviously was in The Eternals as well, Calm with Horses last year. Really great actor, and is one of the up and comers. Colin Farrell, though, I thought really brought the dramatic chops to this. And like you say, Yorgos Lanthimos movies are a very acquired taste. I mean, this is something that is, if you're a fan of one, you're not necessarily going to be a fan of the other. He has a very quirky selection within his filmography. Like, one film is not necessarily like the next. Killing the Sacred Deer, for instance, you can enjoy this and in no way like The Favourite, or, you know, the exact opposite can be true. Yeah, I think this is great. Then, like I say, I'm a big fan of Barry Keoghan in this, and Colin Farrell. I think Farrell as well, brilliant.
So it's in the wee small hours of Sunday morning, 1:10 in the morning. It's on film 4, Killing of a Sacred Deer. It's an unusual one, this one. We've got a little burst. Have we got a little burst of the trailer, Stuart? I think we have, haven't we? Yeah, we have. Although, I've tried to set it up as best I could. The trailer's quite impressionistic, like the film. It's basically a journey, this. So, if you like a trippy old film, check out this one in the wee small hours of Sunday morning.
We don't have to worry about nothing, 'cause we got the fire, and we're burning one hell of a something. They're gonna see us from outer space.
Yeah, I'm really sorry about Bod.
It's nothing serious.
No, it is.
Like we're the stars of the human race. Human race.
Where did you two go?
When the lights started out, they don't know what they heard. Strike the match, playing loud, giving love to the world.
How did his father die?
A surgeon never kills a patient. An anesthesiologist can kill a patient, but a surgeon never can.
Don't be scared, Mom. We'll see. You won't be able to move either. But you'll get used to it.
Where is she? What did you do to her?
And I don't understand why I should have to pay the price. Why my children should have to pay the price.
It's the only thing I can think of as close to justice.
We can light it up, so they can put it out.
Ellie Goulding, as you've never heard her before there, not Ellie Goulding herself, her song there. And one of the reviews in the States said this is the kind of film Alfred Hitchcock would have made had he taken too much LSD. I think there's something too fast. There's some weird suspense filled trippiness to it. And your final recommendation for us is another cracker, Class Action. Now, we've spoken about this before. I don't think you've recommended it before. Have you mentioned it in passing with somebody else, I think?
Oh, no, 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 not class. This is Class Action Park. I have to specify that about class, because there's Class Action with John Travolta from I think the mid to late 90s. Yep. Class Action Park, this is a lot newer. This was released last year, and this came out on HBO Max originally. And there was a Johnny Knoxville film that came out around the same time that's like a narrative version of this story. And you may well have actually encountered this story, Paul, because I think, if memory serves, didn't you? We worked in newspapers in the 80s, I think, didn't you?
I certainly did, yeah. Well, only in local papers down in Devon. We did get a huge amount of dreadful stories in this front, but I've not seen this film at all, so I'm looking forward to hearing about this one.
So this is the documentary about Action Park in New Jersey, which through the 1980s developed a reputation for itself as having zero regard for safety. It was run by a man named Glenn Mulverhill, and what he would do was basically put up any attraction he could think of whatsoever, so long as it got kids and families through the door. He was all about the almighty dollar, did not care one iota for safety or human life. And this was made worse by the fact that they would then start serving booze in the park as well. This is a park that started out as a ski resort, then became an off-season water park, and then was graduated becoming an everything park. It had go-karts, the works. Go-karts that you could tinker with and send to 60 miles an hour if you wanted to. Things like that.
Wow.
And over the course of the 1980s, six people died. And rather than shut the park down, this became part of its brand. They started selling t-shirts, I survived Action Park, and it became this just horrible fact of life that people would go. People were drawn there because of the violence.
When's this one on? When can we see this? I can't wait to see this Sunday now. What time's it on?
This is on a channel I don't think we've ever recommended, Pick, on Sunday night, 9 p.m. on Pick. It's called Class Action Park. If you enjoy the story, which is a fascinating story, Johnny Knoxville, as I say, did a Jackass Presents narrative version of it called Action Point, which came out last year. This is the documentary, though, which is actually a better movie. I've got a clip for you.
I don't think we've got time for the clip, I'm afraid, but we can give you, can you tell us in 20 seconds about your brilliant podcast with Rebecca Perfect? We'll try and play the clip another time. It sounds like a great documentary, though, man.
I check it out, honestly, very worth watching. Great documentary, and you can hear more about it from Bex and I on the Off-Screen Show, which is out from 6 a.m. on podcast platforms, with your guide to everything in cinemas, on streaming and Freeview for the next 7 days. We're actually doing video for the first time this week as well.
Brilliant stuff. I'll be breaking my Pick virginity this weekend and watching Class Action Park, courtesy of Van Connell, on Sunday night. Meanwhile, here is, of course, a bit of a break, and then we're back with Paul Coit after this.